Join us, the Coalition for the Remembrance of Elijah Muhammad, to celebrate our 37th Annual Founders Day on Sunday, March 10th from 5:30 to 7:30 p.m. as we embark on our 37th year as the Archives for the Nation of Islam. As we continue our commitment of sharing the legacy of the Honorable Elijah Muhammad, your support ensures that we continue building this institution of higher learning. We look forward to seeing you Sunday, March 10th at CROE. Call 773-925-1600 for details.
Assalamu alaikum. Peace be unto you. I'm Brother Mandene T. Muhammad. Welcome you to another edition of the Munir Muhammad Show, a CROE Media production with you in mind. I'm honored and always excited anytime I have the opportunity to be a part of a platform to give people an opportunity to come on and express themselves and get their message out and their point of view without all that extra rigmarole and not interruption. This is what we do here as far as CROE Media. And I'm honored to be a part of an organization that has been in existence for 35 years, meaning the Coalition for the Remembrance of the Honorable Elijah Muhammad, the National Archives for the Honorable Elijah Muhammad, and the Nation of Islam. We will be celebrating 37 years in existence this coming Sunday, March the 10th, 5:30 to 7:30, right here at CROE, 2435 West 71st Street. Certainly looking forward to seeing everyone on that evening. We certainly need the support, and we want to be able to receive what we always give out. You know, we give out our opportunity. We want the same opportunity for those that we've supported to come back and support us. And if you're checking us out now, this is a streaming live show. The call-in number is 773-434-6625. Again, that's 773-434-6625. I do have two guests. I'm running a little behind, but it gives me an opportunity to talk a few moments. Also, during this live stream, you can check us out via Facebook, our Facebook page. Just go there. Please like and share the broadcast there. On our YouTube channel, you can like, share, and subscribe so you'll be notified each and every time that we go live. And during this campaign season, we will be going live for the remaining Fridays. Prior to the election, who knows, we'll see how it may go. We may go continue on. We'll see what the crew think. But we'll be streaming live this coming Friday as well at 6 p.m. Also, check out our own website, CROE.org, and click on the CROE Media button from there. Check out the show. Peruse on around. Check out all the great information that's on that page. And scroll back on up and hit that donate button and go ahead and make a donation. Also, I want to encourage everyone that has that's active on social media to follow the CROE National Archives page on Facebook, X, and also Instagram. An abundance of history on that on those pages there, and we definitely believe and we know actually that you would enjoy those pages there. So make sure you check us out, CROE. Archives for the Honorable Elijah Muhammad on CROE, on Facebook, Twitter, was formerly Twitter, is now X, and also Instagram. I wanted to speak about a brother that has made the transition. I didn't get the opportunity this past Sunday. Dr. Ridgely was our guest, and I want to thank him for an excellent job that he did. But as archives, we do have the ability to keep those that have gone before us alive, you know, that memory, you know, whereas via picture, tape, video, or what have you, you know, we have that ability. And one brother that we definitely want to make sure that you all are familiar with is our dear brother Benny, as it's affectionately called, Benny Mahdi Muhammad, or Benny Mo, as those that were close to him would often call him. He was definitely a soldier. He helped Brother Minister Farrakhan in the beginning, in the rebuilding stage. him and his brother as far as securing him and making sure that he was safe and good as far as assisting him. And of course, he has a wonderful family. I spoke to his wonderful daughter, Sister Margaret, that Saturday night prior to his transition, and we had talked for a while at the Legacy Gala. And, you know, we spoke, and she's always so cordial and just a sweet sister. And, of course, his namesake, Brother Benny, and also Brother Farad, and Lord, the other brother's name eludes me right now, but his wonderful family. It just shows you the extension, that Muslim family that we seem to overlook. You know, I know Brother Munir often talks about when he was with us, you know, the importance of burning it, as the Honorable Elijah Muhammad taught, Islam into the hearts of the young people in the family. And just, you know, it's not, he always would say, it's not, you know, if you go go crazy, it's when. And so, but you want to make sure that you put enough in you that you'll be able to come back. And one thing I could say about Brother Benny, he has a large family, and that family is definitely involved in the work and the day-to-day operation as far as the Nation of Islam and assisting Brother Minister Farrakhan. So I definitely want to make sure that I acknowledge that brother and the works that he has, that he did, you know, under that that umbrella, and make sure that I remind you again to show you the importance of an institution like CROE, because we, you know, we do keep people alive. You know, you come in and, you know, people often say, you know, where's my picture? You know, you see your picture along the wall. If you did a show with us, that means you automatically, you know, are part of that history right there. And we have that ability, you know, and we've got that honors from Brother Munir. You know, we brought on everybody, and you know, people that I've, you know, over the years have forgotten. I used to pride myself in remembering everybody that has come on the show, but there's been a few people that have gotten by me. And it's just showed just how many shows that we have done over the years. And I recall Brother Munir, after his transition, we did so many shows that year in 2019 that he made his transition in July of 2019, but we had shows all the way up to December of that year. So much so that a few people didn't even know that he had made his transition. And when I told them, they were shocked. You know, they was like, well, I just looked at him, you know, the other night on the TV show. You know, I said, people have said that numerous times, but it just shows the work ethic that was in that brother and what he instilled in us as far as, you know, doing the teaching, doing the work on behalf of the Honorable Elijah Muhammad. And that's what we're trying to implement today. You know, if we can just do a fraction of the work that Brother Munir did, we would be okay. But we got a long ways to go. We're trying, we're focused, no matter the adversity and the obstructions that may be around us. You know, we got to be like that horse with the blinders on, and just, you know, all we can see is what's right in front of us. And so we're going to stay focused and stay steadfast on that, and I encourage everyone to do the same. I'm about to, you know, that's within the sound of my voice. So, again, I just want to make sure that we acknowledge our dear brother, Benny. By the time that this is aired, even though it's live, his janaza is tomorrow at Lincoln Song's funeral home on 86 in Cottage Grove. And I believe the viewing is at 10, and the actual services start at 11. But you definitely can call the mosque and get more information, just in case I left something out, 324-6000, area code 773. But, of course, we can, at this point, what we can do is just take a piece of candy and just think about the sweet memories of our dear departed brother, who is definitely a soldier in this work. So I want to make sure I get that out the way. I forgot on last Sunday, as I said. So, yeah, but Founders Day. So we're looking forward to seeing everyone on Sunday, March the 10th, and we're very excited. About 37 years, that's nothing to sneeze at. That's a long time doing this type of work. And we encourage everyone to make sure they come out and support us. If you can't make it out, by all means, you know, send a donation in. So I think we have a phone call. Do we have a phone call? I got a floor director. I haven't been told anything. Not yet? Nope. But if you do want to call in prior to that, the number is 773-434-6625. Again, that's 773-434-6625. Got to plug CROE Radio also. Download that Radio Garden app. Search CROE. You can put that CROE in there, and then you can learn more about the teachings of the Honorable Elijah Muhammad in the archives here. You can hear the Honorable Elijah Muhammad and his students 24/7. And definitely worthwhile. So check it out. And they also, we stream live every Wednesday at 2 p.m. on CROE Radio. And look for new shows forthcoming also on CROE Radio as well. So we're working. We haven't stopped. We're focused. And we in it to win it. So, you know, we want to make sure that the teachings of the Honorable Elijah Muhammad will continue to be amplified for those that have never heard it before. Make sure they have heard it. And those that are familiar, make sure that they are reminded, and we can move forward with that. So what I'm going to do, I believe we're going to bring on one of our guests now. So I'm going to go ahead and take a break, and we're going to come back and continue on with the show. So again, that number is 773-434-6625. So let's go ahead and take a break and remind you all again of what's happening this weekend. So we'll be back.
My name is Carmela Muhammad, owner of the Foodie Spot Restaurant and the new Let's Eat to Live restaurant. So what you can expect at both of our restaurants: healthy and clean food with a soulful twist, halal meat, non-genetic modified vegetables, and wild-caught fish. So visit us at the Foodie Spot at 7350 South Stony Island Avenue and Let's Eat to Live at 621 East 67th Street.
Hi, I'm Spencer Leek Jr. In 1933, with the help of God, my grandparents, Reverend and Mrs. A.R. Leek, founded the A.R. Leek Funeral Homes. And now, 75 years later, under the leadership of my father, Spencer Leek Sr., I serve as vice president. While away in college, my professors often told my class that third-generation funeral businesses usually fail. Well, with the help of God and your help, my family and I have proven those professors wrong. So on behalf of my mother, Henrietta, my father, Spencer Sr., our family, and our entire staff, we would like to thank all of Chicago and its suburbs for 75 years of your trust and support. If you should ever need the services of a funeral director, won't you consider calling us? We are located at 7838 South Cottage Grove and 18400 South Pulaski in Country Club Hill. Leek & Sons Funeral Home, large enough to excel in the field, yet small enough to have patience and understanding.
Join us, the Coalition for the Remembrance of Elijah Muhammad, to celebrate our 37th Annual Founders Day on Sunday, March 10th from 5:30 to 7:30 p.m. as we embark on our 37th year as the Archives for the Nation of Islam. As we continue our commitment of sharing the legacy of the Honorable Elijah Muhammad, your support ensures that we continue building this institution of higher learning. We look forward to seeing you Sunday, March 10th at CROE. Call 773-925-1600 for details.
And we are back to the Munir Muhammad Show, and we're not going to be held hostage. We're keeping moving. That's what we've been raised on. So, you know, I guess they'll get here when they get here. But we, in the words of Zeke Thomas from Ruth's Temple, when I used to go to church, I go if I have to go by myself. But I don't have to go this time by myself. I have the senior producer of CROE Media with us. Sister Kim Muhammad, assalamu alaikum, ma'am.
Wa alaikum salam.
So we, we keep it moving. So we got Founders Day coming up.
Absolutely.
That's this Sunday, 5:30 to 7:30. And I'm very excited about that. You know, we adjust. You know, these are challenging times for us right now, not for just for us, but for the world in general.
For everybody.
But this just shows why it's so important, first and foremost, for your faith to be strong.
That's
to strengthen
right.
your faith.
That's right.
You know, as they used to say in the church, get right church and let's go home.
That's right.
So it's very important. So let's give your thoughts on that, and also what's this weekend.
I mean, it's, you know, it's a wonderful time. And of course, you know, when you think about Founders Day, you think about Brother Munir, I think about the faith he had growing up, as you said, in church. thinking about the scripture, faith is the substance of things hoped for and the evidence of things not seen. Mm-hmm. I witnessed that from a brother who truly believed in the Honorable Elijah Muhammad and everything that he said. And then for people to come forward and bear witness to the things that he said based on his belief. And, you know, I was thinking about another scripture that says, you know, it is absolutely impossible to serve God without faith. I think that's one of them in Hebrews somewhere. So I got an opportunity because I grew up wanting to see what faith looked like. I got a chance to see that in Brother Munir. And then because I wanted to be an example of that. So like you said, it's a great day. We've been here for 37 years. I wasn't here in the beginning, but the beautiful thing is I got a chance to get on this bandwagon. And you know, one of the things I always said, Brother Mandene, mm-hmm. was that I never wanted to be on the sidelines. I always wanted to be part of what was going on. And again, I have to say, when I think about you, Brother George, Brother Earl, Brother Amir, I can never thank you all enough and being able to participate with brothers. And there were sisters who joined Brother Munir in this work. And he always said, to know him, you would have to know him in this work. And in this work, he was always trying to help us to see the Honorable Elijah Muhammad.
Yes, ma'am.
So we have our guests here.
Yeah,
so.
I couldn't think of a better way to close out this particular segment. So I thank you.
Thank you.
But this is what we do. That's why he always brought extra people with him.
That's right.
Because you never know what may happen. So we're going to take a real quick break, switch on up and bring our guest on, and then we'll continue on. We thank you. stay tuned, I should say. We'll be back.
Has the only chicken you can reheat and eat. It's good as mother's and better than the others. It is the chicken even mothers love. We've been serving the community for over 30 years. We cook with 100% vegetable oil and are open 7 days a week, including holidays. We're located at 87th and Hermitage. Contact us at 773-429-1812 for your takeout order, or let us provide all your catering needs. For the best chicken of your life, it's Eat and Run.
Join us, the Coalition for the Remembrance of Elijah Muhammad, to celebrate our 37th Annual Founders Day on Sunday, March 10th from 5:30 to 7:30 p.m. as we embark on our 37th year as the Archives for the Nation of Islam. As we continue our commitment of sharing the legacy of the Honorable Elijah Muhammad, your support ensures that we continue building this institution of higher learning. We look forward to seeing you Sunday, March 10th at CROE. Call 773-925-1600 for details.
And we are back to a Munir Muhammad show. Very excited about our next guest. Right on time too. We talking fundraising. We got a money man with us, you know. Joining me for this segment is our dear brother, Dr. Papa Kwesi Nduom.
That's right.
He is the acting president and chairman of GN Bank.
Right.
So we got the right man with us tonight. So how you doing? So welcome to the Munir Muhammad show.
I'm glad to be here.
How are you doing this evening?
I'm good.
I had the honor to talk to you late last year when I was had my stint as far as a radio host on WVON. Mm-hmm. And, you know, I really enjoyed the conversation then. Mm-hmm. But I'm looking forward to it. You know, this is an abbreviated moment. We're definitely going to have you back because you have so much to talk about. But when we talked the last time, you was letting me know that GN Bank is celebrating this year 90 years of existence.
Yes.
Yes, sir. So that's a major thing.
Well, it's a historic moment. We have to go back to 1934.
Let's go. Let's take us on the journey.
1934 is when 13 black men decided that they would make it possible. They'll make it possible for people on this side of the city, particularly on the south side, to own homes, to be able to walk in the front door of a bank, to save their money, and to live a better life.
Yes, sir.
It has taken all that time for this bank to take roots and be here. But it's an interesting story as far as we're concerned. It's an important story. Some good things have happened. Some not so good things have happened. But the history is one that, you know, I have become the, you know, the person to go around and let everybody understand. So I want to share some of that history with you and your viewers. Because those 13 black men, their names aren't mentioned enough. Most people don't know who they are. But I'd like to mention their names here.
Yes, sir.
There was a Dr. John Feeman. He was the president. Dr. James McGahey, he was a treasurer. There was a Mr. Robert Taylor. Now, I'm sure you've heard about the Taylor housing complex. That's that's the Robert Taylor.
Okay.
Okay, he was one of the founders.
Okay.
There was a Dr. Charles Dudley. There was an attorney, Euclid Taylor. There was a Charles Hadnot. There was A.W. Williams, attorney Sidney Brown. I'm sure you know about this name, John Sengstack.
Absolutely.
Okay, he was one of, yes, he was one of the founders. Mr. Chelsea Talley, Rush Yerby, Archibald Carey, Julius Seals, and George R. Arthur. Now, these were 13 men who decided back in 1934 that they would help people on this side of town to be able to bank formally, safely, but most importantly, to own homes.
Yes, sir.
To own homes. And anybody who was anyone who came to town, to the south side of Chicago, to Chicago, period, that was black, that's where they banked.
Yes, sir.
That's where they went for money.
Yes,
that's
sir.
Where they would be welcome.
Yes, sir.
That's where they were accepted. Now, there's also a little known fact that they started with $7,000and started on 70 East 47th Street. That was the first location. Okay. But, you know, many people had account balances of $4, you know, $10, $30.
Yes, sir. I'm familiar
they started
with that.
Small.
Yes, sir.
They started small. But there's another gentleman who many people don't know.
Okay.
Because when the 13 men started this, it was called Illinois Federal Savings and Loans.
Yes, sir.
But there was a service Federal Savings and Loans. And that was started by a Dr. T.K. Lawless. Okay. He's a name some people are familiar with.
Is there a facility named after him? Lawless Gardens?
Yes, exactly.
Okay.
And so he founded Service Federal Savings and Loans. So there was a merger between the Illinois Federal Savings and Loans and Service Federal Savings and Loans in 1975. And that is how come it became known as the Illinois Service Federal Savings and Loans, which was then shortened to be ISF Bank. And then we changed the name 7 years ago. We changed the name for it to become GN Bank. So
yes,
it has gone through a number of different changes, but the same bank, in the same location now on 46th and Martin Luther King Drive. But there's also a little known fact that even though it was 13 black men who started the bank, it was women who made it work. Because they were the clerks at the bank.
That's right.
So you had these people that were attorneys, there were doctors, you know, all sorts of other people. So they were the founders.
Yes, sir.
But the people who actually worked there, who got it going, did the day-to-day work, they were women.
Mm.
And I just want to make sure that people do understand that that's how it got its start. That's how it got its foundation. And also, there were some of the leaders who were women as well.
Mm.
So I just want to mention Louise Lawson was one of the people that was the president and chief executive officer of the bank.
Yes, sir.
At some point. And the bank did well.
Yes, sir.
And then after her came Thelma Smith. So women had played an important and very, very, very good role in this bank being there. And at some point in the 1970s, ISF, or Illinois Service Federal, was the number two black-owned bank in the United States.
Mm.
Okay. So it has had an illustrious history.
Yes, sir.
And foundation. So this year being the 90th, we're going to put the history on. We found some of the original photographs of the people that got there.
And walk down memory lane.
Exactly. So we'll do an exhibition and do a little bit of maybe moving around to show people, particularly young people, where this bank had come from. Because at some point, it became necessary for the bank to move to high schools on the south side.
Yes, sir.
To grade schools on the south side and set up temporary, you know, teller stations.
Yes, sir.
To show them, you know, how you bank, how you open an account.
It's needed. But let me say this, Dr. Ender. We got what I want to do. One thing I want to point out before we take this call and take this break. There's a lot of changes that the bank is going through.
Exactly.
But one thing that has not changed is that it's, as far as it being black owned, it's always been black owned.
Yes.
We can safely say that.
Yes.
Yes, sir. So what I want to do, do we still have that caller? Caller, you are on air. Caller? Caller going once, caller going twice. We're going to keep it moving. This is a fast-paced show.
Okay.
Doc, what I want to do, we have another guest because you're going to be with us for the duration of the show.
Right.
So I want to bring him on and talk to him for a couple of minutes, and then we're going to bring it back, and we're going to continue to give a history lesson on GM Bank, all right?
All right.
All right, so what we're going to do, we're going to take a quick break, and we're going to come back with Commissioner Larry Rogers of the Cook County Board of Review, so we'll be right back.
Searching for a restaurant that serves delicious home-cooked meals at an affordable price like your grandmother used to make? Well, the search is over. Stop by MacArthur's, the new talk of Chicago. We offer a warm atmosphere with friendly service and excellent meals ranging from carryout, dine-in, or catering for your special events. MacArthur's is open 7 days per week from 11 a.m. until 9 p.m. Come visit us at
5412
West Madison Street or call us at 773-261-2316.
You are watching The Munir Muhammad Show, a production of CROE. Please take time to join us at CROE, the Coalition for the Remembrance of the Honorable Elijah Muhammad. CROE is the National Archive of the Nation of Islam and houses one of the largest collections of historical audio, video, and print documentation on the total black experience. CROE is located at 2435 West 71st Street, the corner of 71st and CROE Lane. We are open 7 days a week, 9 to 5. Our number, 773-925-1600. We look forward to seeing you at CROE.
Join us, the Coalition for the Remembrance of Elijah Muhammad, to celebrate our 37th Annual Founders Day on Sunday, March 10th from 5:30 to 7:30 p.m. as we embark on our 37th year as the Archives for the Nation of Islam. As we continue our commitment of sharing the legacy of the Honorable Elijah Muhammad, your support ensures that we continue building this institution of higher learning. We look forward to seeing you Sunday, March 10th at CROE. Call 773-925-1600 for details.
And we are back to the Munir Muhammad Show. I'm going to go ahead and take this call today. You've been holding a call. You are on the air.
Assalamu alaikum.
Oh, wa alaikum salam.
What an awesome story this brother is telling about that bank. I am really enthralled, hanging on to his every word. I grew up in the Robert Taylor homes, and most of my life living there, I had no idea who Robert Taylor even was, except that white actor on TV. Yeah. But I tell you what, man, you know, this story is so intriguing and so wonderful. And we also have a few bucks in that bank, and I appreciate the brother coming on and breaking it down, his history and the people he's talking about. This is so magnificent.
Hey, brother Emmanuel, let me say this, because he's gonna come back. We got Commissioner Rogers right now. But
yeah,
stay.
Okay. Well, let me
no, but listen, here, hold
let
on
me
now.
Make
we can.
One point, brother, and I'm gonna bang up.
No. I want you to stay tuned. He's coming back to finish the story. So stick around.
Oh.
Okay.
Okay. Then I'll do that.
All right.
Yes,
there
sir,
you go.
I want to finish this up. Thank you.
All right, my brother. Thank you, sir. So look, joining us now, if you weren't listening, then I don't know what's going on, but. Commissioner Larry Rogers, Jr. of the Cook County Board of Review. Welcome back to the Munir Muhammad Show, sir.
I'm happy to be back.
Yes, I told you
I was taking out the photographs. I had just memories and all the historic figures. It's just a lovely place to be.
Hey, look, man, I know we're working with limited time, but I have to say this. I've been holding in for a long time. I know I said it to you in person, but I have to acknowledge your father as well. You know,
you.
I know it's been... that was late last year that he made his transition. Mm-hmm. But it has to be pointed out, because as I was sitting there, not only did he have an effect on his children, his family, I mean, his namesake right there is going on with the work, but I saw all of those people that was outside of the family, mm-hmm. that has taken up the mantle. So many people that he has inspired, you know, even extended family. So Larry Rogers Sr., you know, the work that he's done, and you know, you say that you want to be able to recreate yourself and others. Mm-hmm. He certainly have done that. You know, not only his son, but also his relatives and those lawyers that have become judges and everybody else, mm-hmm. who was influenced by Larry Rogers Sr. So I know we hear about the election, but I had to point that out to you.
I appreciate that.
Important.
He was the first lawyer in our family, and we have eight now. My oldest daughter just started at Georgetown Law School, so
yes, sir.
The legacy and tradition continues. So
absolutely.
Appreciate
that. So we can always come back and talk about history with you and your family as well,
mm-hmm.
but right now we're in Chicago, so that
means
it's election season.
It's
man.
Election
so,
season.
So the Cook County Board of Review is a office that a lot of times the people don't really think much of, mm-hmm. especially those that don't have a home, but those
right.
have a home, they definitely, if they're not familiar with you, they should be familiar with you. But before we go, let us know what exactly the Cook County Board of Review does.
The Cook County Board of Review is an agency that was created to basically act as a check and balance on the Cook County assessor. Mm-hmm. So the assessor's job is to go around Cook County and assess properties that's used to calculate your tax bill. And if you think you've been over-assessed, the Board of Review was created to have a place for you to go to challenge that assessment. Mm-hmm. We have no vested interest in maintaining the assessor's value. We look at evidence of value, and we have the authority to lower the assessments. And historically, 6 to 7 out of every 10 people who file an appeal with us, mm-hmm. get some type of reduction.
Yes, sir.
So I've spent the time I've been there reaching out to communities all over Cook County, particularly south and west sides,
yes,
that I was elected to serve, to make sure people have access and opportunity to appeal, they understand the process, and again, we've been fortunate enough to grant them some significant relief.
Yes, sir. And so has it been, I know there's outreach you've
mm-hmm.
been doing, I'm pretty sure.
Community outreach events,
yeah.
both faith-based and community-based.
Yes, sir. And so, clearly, you've been doing the work. Now, we've been hearing a lot that's been going on with mm-hmm. the assessor's office. I haven't had them here since the election, but I know a lot of times they want to try to throw you under the bus, especially like you're the only commissioner, too.
That's right.
You know,
so there's three commissioners.
Yeah.
It takes a vote of two.
Okay.
And the assessor doesn't like to see his assessments reduced. So one of the commissioners currently there is a woman that worked in the assessor's office. So this election right now is really about the assessor both controlling assessments, and now he wants to control the appeals.
Mm.
He wants to over-assess the properties, and then he wants the appeals to be denied. So my race is really about that. He has one vote from his former employee, and now he's looking to get a second vote by running a candidate against me. He's now funded this candidate by the tune of $500,000. to make sure that she gets elected over me. And he spread a lot of lies and misrepresentations, which is unfortunate. So we'll deal with it.
And that's something that somebody would put that amount, not that the office is insignificant, but it's the office that we don't hear about often.
That's
it's not
right.
Like it's the alderman's office or the governor or anything like that.
Right.
But you hear all the money that's going in. Why do you think they do that? I mean, I know why he want to do it, but mm-hmm. you would think they would try to inform the people about what's going on properly instead of putting all this information out. Because it's still, if they really get to looking, they're going to see it's coming back to the assessor's office.
It's coming back to the assessor's office. In fact, the conflict of interest that the assessor has in both endorsing and funding this opponent, he himself acknowledged in December of 21. He said the assessor should not endorse or fund a candidate for the Board of Review because our job is to review their work. Mm. So it's kind of like paying somebody to make sure that your work was deemed okay. Mm. He wants to deny the appeals, which is going to remove this independence of the agency from everyday taxpayers. Mm. So people who think their homes have been overassessed, the appeals will likely be denied by this new candidate if she wins, and people won't have a recourse. It's really unfortunate. That's how people lose their homes, especially in our communities, black and brown communities. When the taxes are high through assessments and the denial of appeals, people can't pay the taxes and they lose their home. So that's really why I'm running.
Yes, sir.
I've been there now 20 years. It's not about pensions. I have a law practice that I'm comfortable with. What it's really about is maintaining the independence of the agency and giving everyday people the access and opportunity to challenge over-assessments.
I mean, I think that's clear. I mean, you're definitely not doing it because you're getting paid a whole lot.
No.
You know, I mean, you know, we just said who your father was. Mm-hmm. I mean, you your name carry weight itself as far as, you know, you in your private and your firm as well. And so, you know, we have to go with what you're saying, you know. Mm-hmm. You're doing this for the people. Clearly, you can be doing something else. So it's important that we stress that. Before we take this call, though, March 19th, of course, early voting has started.
That's right.
Let the people know, you know, your punch number. And, of course, if you're
sure.
open for any volunteers, anything like that to help you out.
Sure. Larry Rogers, Jr., punch 112. The campaign, again, is about independence of the agency and keeping people, giving people and maintaining people access to the agency so they can challenge over assessments and stay in their homes and keep money in their pockets.
Yes, sir. So we still have that caller. Caller, you on the air?
Hello?
Yes. You have a question or comment?
I'm sorry. I needed to move from the TV. Say again, please.
Do you have a question or a comment for Larry Rogers, Jr.?
Yes, please, I do. But first, I acknowledge the importance of what you are doing and the Founders Day coming up, and also the family of Rogers as community leaders and servants going back, of course, to Larry Rogers Sr., who I had the good fortune to know. But I'm calling now because
is it Judge Hubbard?
It is.
And for Larry Rogers Jr., who continues the family excellence,
yes, ma'am,
and service, but also because the importance of the office. It is critical that we keep someone on the Board of Review who actually knows the communities, the whole city, and knows its needs and cares and serves with excellence. So that's really why I'm calling.
Thank you so much, Judge Hubbard. I mean, you're an icon within yourself, ma'am. So I'm honored personally that you are calling in this evening. Did you have anything you want to say to her?
I appreciate her call. She is absolutely an icon and has been a leader. She's the first African-American president of the National Bar Association,
yes,
first African-American president, a female president of the Cook County Bar Association. So we all stand on her shoulders.
Yes,
she's
sir.
Been a leader in the legal profession for decades.
Yes, sir.
I've had a chance to work with her closely in a variety of different settings, and it's always been a privilege and pleasure to stand next to her.
Yes, sir, absolutely. Yeah. Anything else you want to say to us, Judge Hubbard?
Yes, as always, he is a Larry Rogers Jr., like his father, is very deferential and underscores their real importance to all of us. They're generous in their remarks. I can add that in addition to knowing the family and the history and knowing that both Larry Rogers Jr. and his father served as presidents of the Cook County Bar Association, a family tradition of service in that regard, as well as their law practice. So I hope you will permit me to also add my personal gratitude and respect for the work that the law firm does. Mr. Rogers didn't mention it, but he was my most prized attorney in that he represented me in an important cause. It had all kinds of dimensions of public service, civic concerns, fairness in the law and community. And he did it with such excellence. And he stayed the course, because it took a long while for us to finally get to a conclusion, which was all I wanted and more.
Yes, ma'am.
So you'll excuse this personal note, but I also am concerned that we value the service he does on the Board of Review and that people turn out and vote and keep him in that office.
Thank you so much, Judge Hubbard. We really appreciate this phone call, ma'am.
Absolutely. Thank you, Judge.
Yes, ma'am.
I don't know if you recall, but she was disrespected by someone on the plaza of the Daily Center.
I do recall, yeah.
And we took that cause up and
that's
fought
what she's referring
it.
To, yes,
that's
sir.
What she's referring
okay.
to. And in addition to some compensation, we got a written apology to her, showing her the respect that she has garnered in our community.
Yes.
And that's really what I like about doing as a lawyer and as a commissioner. I'm able to fight for our people.
Yes, sir.
And one thing that's insulting about the assessor is if you look at the Board of Review, we have three commissioners. There's one drawn with a majority white community, one district drawn with a majority Latino community, and one with a majority black community. And I've been elected there after being vetted by our community, supporting our community, and then our community supporting me. And now you have Fritz Kagi, a white man, thinking he can choose who will serve the black community. He has won and handpicked a young lady out of the south suburbs and then funded her to the tune of, like I said, over $500,000 to so he can pick who not only reviews his work, but who serves the black community.
Yes,
it's quite frankly an insult to what our democracy is about. It's an insult to what our community is about, and it shouldn't be tolerated by our community.
As we begin to wind down, what was the one thing that you want to leave the people with? Of course, we want you to be reelected, but what should the people really, you know, in a nutshell, understand about the Board of Review?
Sure. The Board of Review, again, it's a safe haven for everyday people who believe they've been aggrieved by the assessors and their property has been overassessed and they're being run out of their homes. So the agency is meant to give you a place to go where you can have it independently evaluated to have the assessments reduced so you can pay fair taxes, not unfair, but something fair, reasonable, and not more than you should be paying. And that is absolutely threatened when you have an assessor who is both endorsing and funding his handpicked candidate, not the community's, his, to review his work. Every appeal that comes through our office has the assessor's value on it. So he's funding someone to maintain those values and deny the appeals, and it's absolutely the it's the opposite of what the agency was created to do.
Yes, sir. Yes,
so
sir.
Hopefully, I can garner the support of your audience. You're a very, very well respected man. I've known you for years.
I'm honored.
Supported the efforts.
Yes, sir.
Of the foundation and my brother Munir. I miss him dearly, but hopefully, I can garner the support of the community and punch 112 on March 19th, and we can get reelected and continue to serve.
There it is. I know you're running. We're going to get you back prior to the 19th. And thank you so much,
thank you.
Commissioner. So I really appreciate that and appreciate this this time.
Right.
So what we're going to do, we're going to go ahead. We're going to take this break. We're going to come back and we're going to continue that history lesson with Dr. Nduom. So we're going to take this quick break and remind you about Founders Day, and we'll be back.
This portion of the Munir Muhammad Show is brought to you by East Lake Management, innovative solutions for building communities of the future today.
Join us, the Coalition for the Remembrance of Elijah Muhammad, to celebrate our 37th annual Founders Day on Sunday, March 10th from 5:30 to 7:30 p.m. as we embark on our 37th year as the archives for the Nation of Islam. As we continue our commitment of sharing the legacy of the Honorable Elijah Muhammad, your support ensures that we continue building this institution of higher learning. We look forward to seeing you Sunday, March 10th at CROE. Call 773-925-1600 for details.
And we are back. I want to thank Commissioner Rogers for that abbreviated moment. And make sure you go out and support him on or before March 19th. So joining me again is our dear brother, Dr. Nduom, who is the acting president. Why acting? Acting president and acting chairman of GN Bank.
Well, acting president but chairman.
Okay. You definitely the chairman.
Yes.
So all you got to do is just vote aye. Yes, sir.
Yes.
So you was giving us a history lesson, and you know, in the remaining time that we have left, you know, definitely have to come back, and so we can just take our time and walk through history. But we want to talk about the importance of supporting a black-owned bank, because as we were talking off air, we had much more, you know, 20 years ago. We only got a few now. But before we do that, remind the people where you're located at, just in case they want to go there tomorrow and open up an account.
Okay, so we're located at 4619 Martin Luther King Drive, and also on 87th and King Drive.
Okay.
But the main branch is 46th and King Drive.
Yes, sir.
And that building was put up in the 1960s by the banks. The bank owns that building. It owns the 87th Street branch as well.
Yes, sir.
It is important to note the history, because if not for the efforts of some of the most recent board members who are no longer there, including the former chairman Norman Williams, this bank would have also gone away. About 20, 25 years ago, we had about 45 black-owned banks in the United States. It went down to 18. Now we're 22.
Wow.
And so when you hear names like the Industrial Bank of Washington, D.C., Liberty Bank of New Orleans, and so on and so forth, and One United Bank of Boston, these are some of the ones that have remained. But this one here is purely and 100% black-owned.
Yes, sir.
And it is important. It's important because you go to many different places. Who sees you? Who talks to you? I just tell you this afternoon, a couple of young men walked to the bank, and they had heard my name. So they asked for me, and they actually were referred to the bank by an attorney called Jason Bell. Now, they came, and I came down to meet them.
Yes, sir.
And they were surprised that, well, here we're meeting the head of the bank, the chairman of the bank, and we sat down and had a good conversation, and we talked about what was in their best interest to do as young business people. And the point is, you cannot do that at Chase. It will not happen at Bank of America.
Yeah.
And I ask people, come to our bank.
Yes, sir.
We will listen to you. We will understand what you're looking for. Yeah. But we are also guided by some of the practices that didn't help the bank, the practices that almost made the bank go away.
Yes, sir.
So if you come looking for a loan, and we know that you cannot afford that loan, that maybe today you can find a little bit of money so you can buy it, but tomorrow it'll become a burden. We will tell you.
Yes, sir.
Okay? We will not just say, oh, we'll take your money now. If you get into difficulty, well, that's your problem. We will not do that.
Yes, good.
We will give you good advice.
Yes, sir.
And so over these past, especially 3 years, we have now been able to support a few people, some of whom perhaps some of your viewers might know. And I'm proud to say that Cliff Rome is Chef one of our Rome. Customers.
Yes, sir.
Chef Rome.
Yeah.
And we're supporting him.
Yes, sir.
And every time I see him, I tell him, we want you to make money.
Yes, sir.
Because you make money, we make money.
That's right.
And your money is here, you make money, your money is secure. And you make money, the money we've given you is also secured.
That's right.
So we're happy to support him. And maybe you haven't heard of an organization called Blacks in Green.
Yeah, I have.
Okay,
heard,
yeah. with Naomi Davis.
Mm-hmm.
We're supporting Naomi. We're supporting Blacks in Green. They're there on the south side. They're the first environmentally correct, but also environmental organizations in the United States that's black. And they are right here in Chicago. And we're proud to be able to support them.
You put your money where your mouth is.
Exactly.
We got a call. We got about 5 minutes left. Caller, you are on the air with Dr. Nduom.
Assalamu alaikum.
Wa alaikum assalam. Welcome back.
Thank you. I'm still listening to this brother. I'm clinging on to his word. Black banks, man, that's a deep subject. We've seen them come and we've seen them go. I would like to ask your distinguished guest, who was this brother that died in a helicopter crash recently? He was a black banker from Nigeria. And secondly, why don't we have some kind of banking connection with Africa since all the wealth of the world is there? And I heard that GN Bank was started also by some African brothers or African. Are you African, by the way, Bob? I'm gonna hang up and listen. What a wonderful show.
Yeah, we all are African by way of the Caucasian, but go ahead, Doc.
Okay, well, he was referring to a gentleman that unfortunately passed away in his 50s.
Whoa.
Just before Super Bowl.
Yes, I did. I heard about that.
And he's from Nigeria.
Mm-hmm.
There's a banker called Herbert Wigwe. And this young man had built the largest bank in Nigeria. Nigeria is the biggest country in Africa. So he had dreams to go to different continents. Okay, and the first continent outside of Africa that he had picked was in Asia. Okay, and so he was making his way and doing a few things, and unfortunately, he had a helicopter crash that
they said it was a little suspicious, but we can talk about that at another time.
So that happened, but the connection the caller is making is an important one.
Yes, sir.
Because for the past 10 years, the majority banks in the world, not just in the United States, but in the world, had started to withdraw from Africa and the Caribbean. Mm. Okay, so if you're a small bank or a bank in Africa or the Caribbean, and you need to establish correspondent banking relationships so that the people there can bank safely and transfer money safely back and forth, that opportunity has been dwindling. It's been going away. Mm. So there's a need for that connection.
Yes, sir.
So some of us, that's part of our aspiration.
Yes, sir.
So that we want to grow a bank like GN Bank so that it becomes bigger, so it becomes safe, so that it has all of the compliance attributes that's required to be able to make the connection. So that if there's somebody in Jamaica, there's someone in Antigua, there's someone in Nigeria, someone in Kenya, that wants to do banking safely in the United States, then they can come to us.
Yes, sir.
And not the individuals, but from bank to bank,
bank to bank.
So that's an important point that he made. That is an important aspiration of ours. That's something that we want to do. But in order for us to do that, we need customers.
Yes, sir.
Okay? And unfortunately, a lot of well-to-do African Americans left the South Side, went to the suburbs.
Mm.
So many of them, who they know is Chase, who they know is Bank of America, but they don't know that there's a GN Bank that can do just about any and everything that any of those banks can do. Because, you know, another time when there's time, I'll show you my bank app, okay, which you can use to do anything.
Yes, sir.
That a Bank of America app can do. Deposit your checks online, use it to go grocery shopping, do whatever it is that you need.
Yes, sir.
That is, and my debit card from GN Bank, when I go to London, that's what I use. Mm. When I go to Ghana, that's what I use.
Yes, sir.
When I go to Jamaica, that's what I use. You know, when I go to, you know, any of the stores around here, that's what I use. And it works better.
Yes, sir.
It works better than some of the other ones. And so, yes, we've gone through some ups and downs. We've had some challenges. But you come to 4619 King Drive, you will know that you have arrived at the bank that's efficient, that can serve you just like any other bank can. But then it has the personal touch. Okay, the personal touch.
Yes, sir.
That when you talk to me, there's nowhere else to go.
Yes, sir.
Okay. When there's a problem and no one can solve it, I am there.
You're there.
And I can solve it for you.
Yeah.
So we're looking to grow. We're looking to develop. We will have some some activities this year to celebrate 90 years of being here. So it's not just longevity, but being able to give value to the community that we're in. Unfortunately, we had some customers who had some loans some years back that shouldn't have gotten them.
Yeah.
And so developing some difficulties. We've worked virtually all of those things out.
Yeah, and I've read about
and
that.
We're getting,
it is not your fault.
Yes.
We got to put a pin in it, but you are definitely coming back so we can have the full show for you to talk about that, because like you said, you need the customers in order to continue to grow.
Right.
But you have everything that all the other banks have, and so we're going to definitely put some emphasis on that. I want to thank you so much, Doc.
But send my greetings to the one person that you know who I am referring to.
Minister Farrakhan.
Exactly.
Yes, sir.
Minister Farrakhan,
yes,
please
sir.
Do.
Yes, sir. On behalf of Dr. Nduom, Commissioner Rogers, the co-founders of CROE Membership, the CROE Media Production Team, my brother Mandene T. Muhammad, may Allah continue to bless you with the light of understanding as I greet you in peace. Assalamu alaikum.